question paper I have seen, that they're giving maximum time. The questions are basically from the logic gates. In every year, the questions are coming from the logic gates, and sometimes from the transistor, but very few times. It's not that in the huge extent that questions are coming from the transistor. And if you see that the questions are basically coming from the PN junction diodes and rectifier, and obviously one question is going to definitely come from your logic gates part. Okay. So, and in the electromagnetic inductions, almost all the topics are important. It is a very important topic, in fact. And because from here, the alternating current is starting. The concepts of the alternating current is nothing without the electromagnetic induction. And it is a very great invention in physics. So let us start. Okay. In the electromagnetic induction first, then we have the discussions on the semiconductor devices. Give me some time. Yeah, right. As I can see, Soheli has also joined. Okay. Just 1 second. Yes, perfect. I hope everybody can see the shared screen. So first of all, today I have made the arrangement in a little bit different manner. So that you can focus on the NCERT part also. And I have picked up all the important notes from the NCERT so that simultaneously you and you see the what are the important things in the NCERT as well. The questions from the NCERT, some of the examples from the NCERT, and some of the questions from the different NEET year papers, so that you can understand that these questions, these patterns are important, actually. And last of all, that we get a mind map, we have the mind map also, so that we can have all the formulas together. But this mind map, you can see it is a little different type of mind map I have found out somehow. Achha. So first of all, we start with the experiments given by Faraday and Henry, okay, in the electromagnetic induction, Faraday and Henry. So the first experiment, so what is that experiment here? Here we are converting that magnetic field to electricity, right? In previously, so far up to the moving charges and magnetism, we have seen that whenever we have electricity, we have magnetism. Okay, it's just the vice versa principle. It is just a reverse phenomena. We have magnetism and we have the electricity. It's a great invention, and which leads to the invention of the AC generator, basically. AC generator and to some extent, transformer also. Okay, where the electricity is not reached so far, and a lot of use in the electromagnetic induction. So here, the first experiment is pretty simple. In this experiment, we have one magnet and we have coil, and this coil is not connected with any kind of cell. Okay, this coil is connected with a galvanometer to ensure whether current is going to pass or not. So whenever we have this magnet and we have brought the magnet is at rest, there is no relative motion present, then we will not see any kind of deflection in the galvanometer, which means that there is no induced current in the coil. But whenever there is a relative motion present, If you either move the magnet towards the coil, or if you move the magnet away from the coil, then of course you can see the current over here. This is the first observation. Okay, there are a couple of experiments done by Faraday and Henry to understand the electromagnetic induction process. The same thing here, we have seen what? Here we have another coil, which is connected to the battery. You know, whenever the current passes through the coil, it behaves like a solenoid. It behaves like a solenoid and it produces its own magnetic field. It will behave like a solenoid. And it will have its own magnetic field. Now, whenever we have a relative motion between this coil and this coil, then also we have seen induced current is going to be found in this galvanometer. But Faraday has not given the direction of the induced current. It was given by Lenz. You know that. It was given by Lenz afterwards. Now only the phenomenon has been described by the Faraday. So here also induced current is found, but whenever the moment this coil gets stopped, there is no relative motion present, then no current is induced. Then the galvanometer deflection also becomes, reaches to the null point. Okay. In the third experiment, we have a tapping key here. This is a tapping key. This is one tapping key. So with the help of the tapping key, now we are not making any magnet, any coil move towards each other. Both the coils are raised at its own position. Okay, both the coils are raised at its own position. So here no relative motion. No relative motion. But what we do here, we tap the key continuously. Whenever we tap the key, so it will have its magnetism on and off like this. Magnetism will be on, magnetism will be off, magnetism will be on and off. So here also, then we have seen a current is found in the galvanometer. So in this three experiment, our motto is to, what is our motto? To understand whether there is any kind of change of magnetic flux or not. Okay. So in everywhere in this experiment or this experiment, we have change in magnetic flux. Flux mane flow. Flow mane what? Flow of what? Flow of electric field lines. Okay. So let's change in magnetic flux. With respect to time. Leads to induced current. Okay. It leads to the induced current. Now, first of all, the current will not be there. First of all, we will be getting an induced EMF across the ends of the coil. And if the coil is completed, if the coil is, it is forming a loop, if the circuit is completed, then only current will start flowing. If the circuit is not completed, for example, then the current will not flow. Then the charge accumulation will take place. The EMF will be generated, just like what happens in a case of motional EMF for a rod. Whenever we have a rod simply and the rod is moving through the magnetic field, then we have a motional EMF. You might have observed this thing where you have a rod and this rod is moving in a magnetic field with some part of velocity. It moves with some part of velocity. So one part is going to get positively charged. Why? Because inside the rod, let me draw this thing. You can understand it properly. So this is the rod, right? And the rod is moving with some velocity V. Tell me in what direction the positive charge going to experience the force. The positive charge will experience the force in what direction here? Tell me. Here the positive electrons and the positive charges are there. Now electrons are positive charges. So electrons are going to experience force in what direction? Apply the right hand thumb rule or palm rule, whatever magnetic field direction of the
upward direction.
Positive charge will be accumulated in the upward direction. And all the electron will reach over here. So this become entirely positively polarity, positive charged, and this is becoming negatively charged. So we have set a potential difference, but current is not flowing. Current is not flowing, but a potential difference has been created. But from the moment I join the wire, suppose we have an LED and connecting that, then the current will start flow. Okay. But it is not that it may ask, my question sometimes asks that, whenever we do not have a completed circuit and the this rod is moving in the magnetic field with some velocity V, will there be any kind of induced EMF? Okay, yes, induced EMF will be there, but induced current is not going to be there. For current, we have a complete circuit. Okay, so this is the thing, Faraday's experiment. So first of all, and how we write down, we have seen the flux is written as what? BA cos. Now the concept of flux we have here in the next slide, so I don't have to waste time over here. So this is the magnetic flux. So magnetic flux, what? Magnetic flux means flow of field lines. Flow of field lines. But there is a way of flow. How the field lines flows? How does the field line flow? Field line flow perpendicularly to the surface area. Okay, the number of field lines passing perpendicularly per unit area, we call that is the amount of flux, isn't it? This is what we call as flux. But here we have taken the field lines which is arbitrary field lines. It is not perpendicular to the surface area. Area vector is perpendicular to the surface. So this is the direction of area vector and this is perpendicular to the surface. If I talk about the plane of the surface, so this is the plane of the surface, for example. Just 1 second here. And with that, this is perpendicular. This is the perpendicular, right? This one is the perpendicular. Area vector is making perpendicular angle. I'm magnifying this diagram. But here the magnetic field is not passing perpendicular to the area vector. So for that we have a general expression. We find out a component of B along the direction of area, because I only take those components of magnetic field lines which is passing perpendicular to the area. So we have to consider the B cos theta over here. And what is the flux then? Area multiplied by B cos theta, because we have seen flux is proportional to the B cos theta. If you have more number of magnetic field lines, more is the flux. If you have more amount of surface area, more is the flux. Well, from there, phi equals to BA cos theta. Everybody knows that phi equals to BA cos theta. So from there, B dot A vector. Achha. Now, induced EMF is because of rate of change of magnetic flux. Hai na? Induced EMF is because of rate of change of magnetic flux. So d phi by dt. This is the rate of change of magnetic flux. So d by dt of BA. BA cos theta, basically BA cos theta, or if I talk about the magnetic fields are already passing perpendicular, so BA. If the magnetic field, maybe the magnetic field constant, maybe the area vector constant, depending on the scenario. Okay, depending on the scenario, area can be changing also. In some cases, it is given the circular loop and the radius is shrinking by a rate of this one. Find out the induced EMF. Okay, for example, if I tell you, say, we have a circular loop, okay, and the area, it is written as area, so you know that area pi r squared to pi r. So it is given that its radius is shrinking at a rate of 1 millimeter per second. Okay. And suppose the magnetic field is here perpendicularly downward, inward. The value of B is given as 10 to the power 4 Tesla. Okay. The question is, what will be the induced EMF when the radius is 20 centimeter? So its radius is shrinking at a rate of 1 millimeter per second. Okay. So like what will be the induced EMF when the radius is 20 centimeter? How we can get this answer? Will induced EMF be there? Will I get any induced EMF? Yes, because the area is changing. Because phi changes, mane either B changes or A changes or your theta changes. Theta changes how? Rotation. How will you get this answer? Tell me the answer.
Four pi.
Acha. So here area, we know that is pi r square. So like dA by dt, we have to understand actually. Acha, I have missed out some. I have not missed out anything. dA by dt is 2 pi r dr by dt. Isn't it 2 pi r dr by dt? Now this dr by dt is given 1 millimeter per second. Okay. Because with what rate it is shrinking? 1 millimeter per second. dr by dt, the rate of radius shrinking, it is 1 millimeter per second. So we have 2 pi r into 1 millimeter per second. Now we have to find out the induced EMF, which is d phi by dt. So d phi by dt, mane here B constant. B constant dA by dt. So dA by dt we have already found out. The value of B, you know, this is 2 pi r dr by dt. That's all. Everything is given. B value is given. Radius is given. At what radius you have to find out. It is also given 20 centimeter. It is 1 millimeter. So convert into all of them. You convert into meter. You are going to get your answer in then volt. Right? Okay. That's all. you have to solve like this. Achha, we have one more example on the electromagnetic induction on the Faraday's law. Try to say, tell me the answer. This is also an NCERT example. Vertically east west plane, east west plane vertically like this. Okay, this is east side, this is the west side, right? So vertically it is kept vertically, horizontally when it is like that. Okay, it is kept like this. Now the magnetic field is 0.1 tesla is set up across the plane in the northeast, in the northeast direction, right? This is the direction of magnetic field. This is your plane. It's very difficult to show you in two dimensional diagram, but I'm trying to show the diagram as much as it is possible. So this is the position of your square loop actually. Okay, east-west plane. What is that east-west? This is your east-west plane, na? This is the east-west plane, east side, west side. And here the magnetic field is acting at directions of along this. It is given to you. This is the direction of the magnetic field, which is at the northeast direction. This is your northeast direction, Anna, which is at an angle of how much?
45 degrees.
Already it is 45 degree. You don't have to, this value is not, will not be given. Achha. The value of magnetic field is also given to you. The direction of magnetic field is decreased to zero in 0.7 second. So the magnetic field is, the final magnetic field is zero. How much is the timing? Timing is 0.7 second. So if final magnetic field is zero, the final flux is also going to be zero. BA cos theta, na? Phi equals to BA cos theta. So the final flux is also zero. Now what about the initial flux? Initial flux is going to be BA cos 45 degree here. Na? BA, mana B cos 45 degree. Multiplied by the area vector. Area is also given to you. The side is given 10 centimeter. You can find out from there. Achha. So, like, phi I is equal to that one. Phi F is equal to that one. So, like, I naturally can find out the epsilon equals to phi F minus phi I divided by time t. Here, because it is not a time function, already it, the final flux and the initial flux are specified. So you don't have to worry about the differentiation bala, you know, formula. Phi F minus phi A phi I divided by T. This is BA cos 45 degree minus 0 divided by 0.7. Everything is given. You can get the value of epsilon, and from there, the value of I is going to be epsilon divided by the resistance of the coil. Simply. Okay. I hope that everybody has done this. This much of problems you already are familiar of. I know that. But this type of question may come also. It's not that it is not important, because I've gone through the papers that Faraday's laws are, when a question are coming from the Faraday's law also. Okay. Achha, I'm coming to the next problem. Tell me what about this answer. Here we have a number of turns. তাহলে বি এ কস জিরো বি এ কস 90 বেসিক্যালি। ফাইনাল ফ্লাক্স ইজ হাউ মাচ হিয়ার? Eight hundred coil effective area this much is kept perpendicular to the magnetic field. So first of all, it is perpendicular to the magnetic field. The area is kept perpendicular. The initial flux is zero. Initial flux is zero, and then it is rotated by an angle of 90 degree. Final flux you have to find out. So phi I is equal to zero over here. Why phi I is zero? Because here theta equals to 90 degree. Cos 90 degree is zero. Area vector and the magnetic field here B is perpendicular to area vector. So it is zero. Phi I is going to be zero here. And what about the phi F? Final flux. It is B A cosine of 0 degree. Right now it is going to be 0 degree. Why it is 0 degree? Because initially this is the field line and this is the area vector. Now it has gone through by an angle of 90 degree. Now field lines, magnetic field line and the area vector will be having the 0 degree angle. So it is cos zero. We are writing cos zero. So finally, final flux is how much? The magnetic field is given. Is 5 × 10⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻⁻ calculating, you can do the calculation part. The magnetic field is given, area is given 0.05 and cos 0 is 1 and divided by the time. Time is given 0.1 second. So we can find out the rest. So here also epsilon m equals to phi f minus phi I divided by the time 0.1. So it is simply BA divided by 0.1. So B is how much? 5 into 10 to the power minus 5. Area is 0.05. 0.05 whole square. Right? Oh, sorry.
Area deva.
I thought sign. So multiplied by 0.05 divided by 0.1. Okay, this is going to be your calculation. Subtract calculations, how much it is coming? Can you tell me?
0.02
is coming after the calculation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. 0.02.
এই ফোনটাতে ক্লাস করতে চুপকম মানে আটকে যাচ্ছিল আমি বিশ্বাস করতে পারি নতুন ফোনটাতে লেখা বুঝতে পারছি না একটাও তা
ওকে ডান নেক্সট দীপানি তার ফোনে কি প্রবলেম আচ্ছা ল নাও উই হ্যাভ দ্য কনসেপ্ট অফ লেন্সেস এন্ড হিয়ার আই হ্যাভ টেকেন ওয়ান অফ দ্য নোট ইউ ক্যান আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড ফ্রম ইউ নো দিস ইজ নট দিস ডায়াগ্রাম ওয়াজ নট গিভেন ইন দ্য এনসিইআরটি আই হ্যাভ জাস্ট মেক অ্যান অ্যাড অন Do you know what kind of you might have seen this thing in different cases? This is called perpetual machine. I'll tell you what is that part. It is an impossible machine actually. In fact, I'll tell you what is that. It is given in the NCRT line. It's very interesting. So Lenz's law and the conservation of energy. Lenz's law is basically from the conservation of energy. Here we find out the direction of induced EMF. And what was Lenz's law? The direction of induced EMF, in that direction of induced current, sorry. The direction of induced current is such so that it always opposes the cause for which the current generates. Okay. Okay. The direction will be such so that it always opposes for which the current generates. Here, the north pole of the magnet is coming towards this circular loop. This circular loop will behave like a magnetic moment. And this phase will create a north pole. So that only then the north pole will be getting repelled. Now, the cause is what? For what the induced current is generated? For the motion of the magnet. Here, current we are getting because of the motion of the magnet. So you have to first of all find out the root cause. So first of all, find now whenever this type of question will come to find out the direction of induced EMF, find out the cause, find root cause. So after then. If you find out the cause, then you have to stop the cause, right? You have to stop the cause. Stop the cause. And for stopping the cause, whatever necessary action you have to take, you have to understand them. Tale here North Pole is coming towards this loop. Tale if the North Pole is the response, if North Pole of the magnet is if the motion of the magnet is responsible for the electromagnetic induction here, tale the pole current will be such, the loop current will be such, so that it opposes the motion. Tale how it can oppose the motion? So that it will create its own magnetic field in such a way. And how it can oppose? The North Pole will be there. If it is the North Pole along this side, then opposition will take place. Then if the North Pole, then you know how the direction of induced current looks like. Then from this side, you have to watch. You are actually observing now. Student makes mistake from what side they will watch. They get confused on that. From this side, you are watching. If you see the loop from this side, the loop direction is going to be changed. Okay, in what directions the magnet is moving, from that direction you are actually the loop direction, anti-clockwise or clockwise. Here it is anti-clockwise. Similarly, here the North Pole is going away from the magnet. The magnet ki bolbe, magnet bolbe. Okay, you don't know. You don't go, you stay. Okay, because the magnet is trying to go away. This is the cause of magnetic flux. This is the cause of EMI. So the loop doesn't want to let him go. Okay. So for that, what can happen? This is going to be the South Pole. Then it is only possible. Then if it is South Pole, it is going to be clockwise direction for the current. So whenever the magnet moves in, anti-clockwise, whenever the magnet goes out, clockwise. So anti-clock, clock, anti-clock, clock. If you make a periodic motion in the magnet, then we are going to get a basically alternating current. If you connect it, this loop is connected with the help of galvanometer. You will see the galvanometer deflection will right, left like that. If you do a periodic motion in the magnet. Okay. This is our Lenz's law. Now Lenz's law leads to conservation of energy. It is absolutely from the conservation of energy. Here, I want to give focus. Suppose, for example, it is not the North Pole. I'm telling you how the conservation of energy will violate how the conservation of energy is going to be violating. If it is happening in an opposite manner. Suppose you are making the magnet move and this pole is suppose somehow South Pole. If it is South Pole, then what will happen? This is to continuously attract the magnet. Well, if I just make the magnet move from its own position, if I just give a little push to the magnet, then the magnet will automatically move towards the coil. Are you getting my point? If I just give a little push to the magnet, the magnet will automatically move towards the coil. The magnet will not be recording any kind of further energy. Without energy, magnet can move. But without energy, is it possible the work will be done? That means it is a kind of perpetual machine. Perpetual machine means you are not applying any kind of force, but the work is being done. There is no external source of energy, but the energy energy can be produced without any energy source. We know that energy is always being transformed. Energy is always being transferred. There is no source of energy. Energy cannot be created. No source of energy, energy cannot be created, cannot be manufactured. But here we are manufacturing energy. We are just giving a little push and the magnet is automatically moving towards the coil. That means it is a kind of infinitely energy source. It is not taking the energy from anybody, but it is producing its own energy. It is not possible. This is what we call as perpetual motion. It is written over here. Without expending, will continuously increase without its kinetic energy. A gentle push on the magnet will initiate the process. A gentle push will initiate the process and its velocity and kinetic energy will continuously increase without expending energy. And if this can happen, one could construct, you can understand it is written, one could construct a perpetual motion machine by a suitable arrangement. And here we have given a diagram of perpetual motion machine. Perpetual motion machine, you can see in this arrangement, this is actually perpetual motion is not possible. First of all, let me tell you, it is impossible to construct. Impossible to construct. You can type it on the YouTube and you can search a video on that. It is given already, perpetual motion machine. Here, whenever you give a little, you just little bit rotate this wheel, then wheel doesn't require any kind of energy. Wheel will rotate infinitely. For infinite time, it will keep rotating. Okay, how it will be rotating? The see the system is kept in such a way, na? Whenever you are going to little bit rotate it, then this ball will come. Whenever this position will come down, then this ball will roll automatically because of that push. It will come down. Then this ball automatically, whenever it is going up, this ball will gradually take this position. Hana, this ball is going to take this position. This ball is going to take this position whenever it is going to get up. Are you getting my point? Then whenever this ball gets put to this position, automatically this ball will be getting arranged over here. And whenever again it is going to rotate, because it is continuously happening. So some balls are responsible to make this wheel giving a force along this direction, these balls. Okay. And whenever this ball are reaching over here, it automatically takes this position. The like continuous torque is acting. The moment I have given an initial force, a continuous torque is acting and it is rotating without any external source of energy. This is what we call as perpetual motion. Okay. The like perpetual motion can be found out, but it is not possible in nature. But because there are so many damping force and all, we cannot make that happen actually. Acha, you can see this diagram in YouTube. I'm telling you, you can search on the perpetual motion machine in YouTube and you can get a beautiful simulation on that. Here now, on the basis of Lenz's law, the direction of induced EMF, you have to give this answer. Here we have three. This question is from the NCERT also. You can see NCERT not to be published, it is given already. Acha, we have three loops. One loop is, it is getting inside the magnetic field. This loop is getting out. This loop is also getting out of the magnetic field. You have to find out the direction of the induced current. Tell me, what about the first? What will be the direction of induced EMF for the first? Yes, Dipanita. Dipanita wants to say something. Yes. Unmute and tell. Don't be shy. Give the answer.
Anti-clockwise.
Mane, anti-clockwise, mane here in terms of ABCD, you have to tell me. Mane CD, AB, you are saying. CD,
yes.
Mane ABCD basically. Achha, why anti-clockwise? Because it is getting in. It is getting in. Mane magnetic field is increasing. Magnetic field is increasing. It will try to do what? It will try to decrease the magnetic field, because increase of magnetic field is a cause. So for here, cause is increase of magnetic field. So it will stop the cause. I mean, it will try to oppose the cause. So it will try to decrease the magnetic field. So if the loop itself has to decrease the magnetic field, the loop should create the magnetic field in what direction? Upward directions. Yes, of course, in the upward direction. So a loop should create its own magnetic field in such a way so that the magnetic field is perpendicularly outward. So outward, mane, if you apply the right-hand thumb rule, in what direction current is flowing? Yes, clockwise direction. No, clockwise, no, anti-clockwise direction. CDAB. Okay, so this is going to be an answer, CDAB. Acha. Then tell me, what about the number 2?
Clockwise.
It is going to be clockwise because it clockwise. Is going out. So here the root cause is the decrease of the magnetic field. So it will try to increase the magnetic field. And if it has to increase the magnetic field, it should also create a magnetic field in the downward direction. Then only it can increase. Na? Okay. So it is clockwise direction. What about this one? This is also the same. It is also anti-clockwise direction. I'm not going to give it anymore. It is also anti-clockwise direction because it is going to go out from the magnetic field direction. Okay. So a brief thing. I hope everybody has remembered the old days. We have already done those things actually. Can I go next? Lenz's law understood. Now this can be come in, this question can come in terms of bar magnet also. I hope you can give this answer. But maximum possibilities here. Now the next topic that we are going to cover, that is our motional electromagnetic force, motional EMF. Okay, whenever I have just told you, whenever we have a rod of length L moving with a velocity V in the magnetic field, তাহলে ইট শুড ক্রিয়েট দ্য ইলেক্ট্রোম্যাগনেটিক ইলেকট্রোম্যাগনেটিক ইন্ডাকশন ইন্ডিউসড ইএমএফ উইল বি দেয়ার বাট নো কারেন্ট ইজ গোয়িং টু ফ্লো বিকজ ইট ইজ নট কানেক্টেড টু এনি এক্সটার্নাল সার্কিট বাট ইট উইল বিহেভ লাইক এ ব্যাটারি ইট উইল হ্যাভ ইটস ওন পোটেনশিয়াল ডিফারেন্স ওকে tell me in this particular scenario what is going to be the positive polarity and what is going to be the negative polarity can you tell me what is going to be the positive polarity and what is going to be the negative polarity here tale direction of magnetic field is inside motion is this one tale positive charge will experience a force in the downward direction hai na tale the downward part is going to be the positively charged and the upward part is going to get negatively charged so it will be up like a battery like here we have isn't it it will behave like a battery like this this is going to be the polarity of the cell acha now that is not my concern my objective is to calculate the how much amount of induced emf will be there we have found out using the faraday's law only e equals to minus d phi by dt now we are taking minus also into our consideration from lenz's law because of the opposition wala case hai na okay minus d phi by dt now here what is that the minus d by dt of blx here it is minus d by dt of blx at a distance of x I have taken at a distance of x to blx now because b into l is going to be the l into x is going to be the area it is the x so how much area it has gone through how much area mean rate of change of area na what is changing here magnetic field is not changing what is changing here flux is changing because of area is changing how the area is changing this area is changing na because as you move the block as you move the rod along this direction or this direction here area is shrinking area is decreasing understood tale area is how much is the area right now l into x is my area l is not changing what is changing x is changing tale blx b into a this is a is the area tale bl dx by dt dx by dt mane velocity so from there blv very important expression question are coming from this particular topic motional emf is very much important you probably get the question from the motional emf only either from the rotating rod or from the moving straight rod okay and the second one bl this is an further add on with this motional emf here we have a rotating rod instead of a rod going straight we have a rotating rod and the angular frequency of rotation is given or the natural frequency of rotation is given tale here the rod is now rotating along this path okay so what we have done here at a distance of x here also we have done in the similar manner at a particular distance we have taken some elementary length here okay of dr say and this dr is moving is having a velocity of v of course along this direction if the rod actually rotates along this direction with an angular frequency of omega tale this is your v okay and I, how you can express v equals to omega r now I have taken the distance as at a distance of r this distance is r from here this distance is r tale v equals to omega into r v equals to omega into r tale here this part this small elementary length that I have shown over here this small elementary length is going along this direction tale how much motional emf will be generated because of this small elementary length blv now it is br it is going to be what blv we write l is the length of the rod now here the length of the rod is dr elementary length dr tale b into r into v b into dr into v tale now I have to integrate tale v I have expressed now omega r tale integration over now for the entire rod 0 to r tale 0 to r b omega r dr so finally we get b omega r square by 2 in some book it is written length of the rod tale b omega l square by 2 also basically we are quite familiar with the length l tale this formula also l is the length of the rod because actually length is acting as the radius of the circular path very famous expression question are coming from this topic various in various places okay very important give a focus on this particular topic, because I hope that question may come from that particular topic also. B omega L square by 2. One of the most important part in this chapter. Achha, let us solve one problem now on the basis of this concept. NCRT problem. The 10 metallic spokes each of 0.5 meter long is rotated at the speed of 120 revolution per minute. Like from here, 120 revolution per minute, it is actually the natural frequency. If from there, I can say this is 120 divided by 60, which is 2 revolution per second. This is our natural frequency. So from there, you can find out the value of omega, which is 2 pi into F. This would be known actually. So 2 pi, and this is going to be 4 pi then. 4 pi radian per second, right? The omega we have, the magnetic field we have, this is 0.4 gauss, and 1 gauss equals to 10 to the power minus 4 tesla. So the value of the magnetic field is actually 0.4 into 10 to the power minus 4 tesla, okay? And the length of the rod is given 0.5 meter. So length of the rod is 0.5 meter. This is your L, okay? Emotional EMF will be because of 10 metallic spokes. We have 10 metallic spokes like that. Is rotated. What is the induced EMF? The induced EMF associated with one spoke for one spoke. It is B omega L square by 2. You can apply. Everything is found out now. We have all the data. We have omega. We have the length. Also, and we have the value of magnetic field also. So you can, I hope that you can do the rest of the calculation. Okay, and you have to finally multiply with the 10 to get the total EMF because of the 10 spokes, isn't it? Yes, Tina, Kousiki, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir.
Yes.
বলছি যে এখানে তো হরাইজন্টাল কম্পোনেন্টটা বলেছে তাহলে রিয়েলটা বের করতে হবে না
ইফ উইল উইথ দ্য স্পেক্স আর রোটেটেড উইথ দ্য স্পিড অফ 120 নরমাল কম্পোনেন্ট হরাইজন্টাল কম্পোনেন্ট অফ দ্য স্পিন্ডল না হুইল ইজ হাউ দ্য হুইল ইজ রোটেটিং হাউ দ্য হুইল ইজ রোটেটিং হুইল ইজ রোটেটিং অ্যালং দিস ডাইরেকশন রাইট মেটালিক স্পোকস with the speed of this one normal to the horizontal component it is already given the normal to the horizontal component so it is already 0 degree now the area vector the area the direction of L and V the I mean B is actually in the normal direction only so you don't have to do anything here okay B omega L square by 2 maximum probability that it is going to come from the rotational EMF only acha now we'll go for the inductance little bit what is inductance you know that What is inductance? For a closely wound n number of turns, the same magnetic flux is linked with all the turns. Okay, tale n phi proportional to I. The phi is going to proportional to be, the phi is going to be proportional to I. Phi equals to L I, na? Phi is proportional to I. We have seen that for one loop we have, and phi equals to L into I, where L is the coefficient of cell inductance. Isn't it? This is the coefficient of the self inductance. Acha. So a term called flux linkage is used, which is equal to n phi for a closely wound coil in such a case, and n phi b proportional to I, and n phi b equals to L I. So L equals to n phi divided by I. For n number of loops, L equals to n into phi divided by I. This is our coefficient of self inductance, whose unit is in Henry. Inductor, we call na inductor any kind of solenoid behaves like, whenever the current is increasing to the solenoid, then a flux is linked, flux gets linked. If the current is constant to the solenoid, then flux is not going to link, magnetic flux is going to be remaining constant. But whenever there is a growth of current or decrease of current, for example current falls down or current grows in, then the flux will link, flux will change in the solenoid. Understood? Initially suppose the less amount of current, less flux. Now current gradually increases, so flux is also increases. So increase of flux money induced EMF will be there. Now solenoid will behave like it will have its own electricity. Okay, acha. This is, and how much ability it is having, this is what we call as coefficient of self inductance, the L. Now on the basis of that, let us solve one problem. Tell me, what about this answer? It is there for the question of NEET 2016 also, as I can see here. Today, are you getting any issue in the voice regarding? Are you no? This microphone is good, but it cannot catch the voice if I go at a little bit away from the microphone. Now the voice is a little bit dim, I think. Now, can you hear my voice still? Low. Now it is okay. I have to take a microphone like Dr. Kaur using that AKG wala microphone. It's pretty nice. This is the best microphone. I have AKG microphone, but it is a instrumental microphone. The microphone that is connected to guitar, or I have the violin actually. So there you can connect that microphone. It cannot catch the voice, but it can catch the instrumental sound very well. So the solenoid has 1,000 turns. Give me the answer. I need the answer. Any of the option is correct.
1 Henry.
So 1 Henry. Oh, everybody is agreeing with 1 Henry. Everybody has found out.
Yes,
sir. Yes, Ankita. 1 Henry.
Yes, sir.
Acha. So the waiver, the magnetic field is given to you. The flux is given, 4 × 10⁻³ waiver. The self inductance you have to find out, 1,000 turns, 4 ampere. Like here, just L equals to n into phi divided by I. Simply you have to calculate. So this is 10³ multiplied by 4 × 10⁻³ divided by the current is 4 ampere. It gets cancelled out. And we have 1 Henry. Very good. 1 Henry is the answer. Acha. Now we'll discuss on a little bit mutual inductance. You know, mutual inductance takes place because of flux linked, change in flux in one coil, the induced EMF in another coil. We have two coils instead. Okay, here we have a small, solenoid. We have two coaxial solenoids here, you can understand. One solenoid is having the radius R1 and the bigger one is having the radius R2. The flux change in one coil, we are getting induced EMF in the another coil. Okay, if the flux changes in this first coil, the induced EMF is going to get in the another coil. Why? Because in the another coil is there in the magnetic field of the first, obviously, na? If the flux changes over here, then the flux for this bigger coil is also going to get changed. তাহলে when current I2 is set up here, I2 is set up through the S2. So for the bigger coil we have I2 current. Okay, for the bigger coil we have I2 current. I2 is set up in S2. It in turn sets up the magnetic flux through S1. Obviously, if we have the magnetic field because of the S2, we have the magnetic flux linked through the smaller solenoid, right? Let us denote it by phi 1. So flux because of S2 is phi 1. Flux because of S2 is phi 1. Then the corresponding flux linkage with the solenoid S1 is N1 phi 1. N phi because of N number of turns in the first solenoids. For the first solenoid, here we have N1 number of turns. N1 phi 1 is the total flux. This phi 1 is because of S2, right? This is equals to M12 into I2. M12 means mutual inductance in 1 because of 2. Mutual inductance in 1. Induced EMF in 1 because of 2. Okay. Multiplied by current in the I2. This is how we express. Similarly, vice versa, if we have the current here in the smaller coil, then N2 into phi 2 equals to M21 into I1. The reverse one. If we have the current over here, and we have a magnetic field over here, so it will have the magnetic flux. The mutual inductance will be there in the bigger coil in two because of the change in current in one. Okay, this is how we express the mutual inductance. And there is no, I've not seen as much as question from the mutual inductance. Maximum times I've seen that the questions are coming from the self inductance. And also another important part that I'm going to discuss right now here, the energy associated with the inductor. This expression is pretty important. I have seen questions are coming from that part particularly. Energy associated with the inductor. You know that expression. Energy stored in inductor. This formula is important. From here, you can get the question. Not only direct, it will not be directly asked. Suppose that type of question is given that we have solved just right now, this question. From here, inductor is supposed to calculate, then you have to find out the energy. May not be directly asked that this is the inductor, this is the current, find out the energy. No, not like that. But the question is constructed in such a way, first of all, you have to find out the inductance, then you have to find out the magnetic energy stored in the inductor. Okay. Acha, we have a question from the self-inductance, mutual inductance also I have collected. Tell me in which of the case here the mutual inductance is going to be maximum. Then I can go to the next problem.
In option A,
option number one, yes, because here in the option number one, because of current in any of the coil, the flux linked with the second coil is going to be maximum. More is the flux, we have more mutual inductance. Okay, and in this is kept perpendicularly, and this is here. So here the flux we are going to get like this. So here no more amount of flux. Here also same thing. Here also you are going to get the flux like that. But here you have the maximum number of flux which is going to pass through this second coil, secondary coil. Okay, so option number one. Achha. Now, here I have taken a very important concept actually. You might have known this concept earlier. Often the expression for the magnetic energy in the solenoid, magnetic energy, though you already know half Li square, this expression we have already familiar with. Now, I'll tell you to focus on these two calculations. The magnetic energy per unit volume, how you write down B square divided by 2 mu 0. And electrical energy stored, half epsilon naught E square. You know that this is three expression. These three expressions are important. That's why I have taken act actually. Energy stored in the capacitor is half C V square. You know LC oscillation also. Whenever you have studied alternating current, how the magnetic energy converts into electrical and how electrical energy converts into magnetic LC oscillation. Whenever inductor and capacitor are in series connection. Yeah. So, obtain an expression for the magnetic energy stored in the solenoid in terms of magnetic field V, area, and the length L. Tale, in terms of magnetic field, area, and the length, we can write down 1 by 2 mu 0 B square into AL. Dekho, half Li square L, I hoche koto, B by mu 0 N, because B equals to mu 0 Ni from the solenoid, you know. You have to remember this expression actually whenever it is given for the solenoid. That is why I'm giving this. We have this note actually for you. This is from the NCERT, absolutely from the NCERT only. 1 by 2 mu 0 b square into a into l in terms of area, length and magnetic field of a solenoid. Okay. Tale half li square, we know b equals to mu naught n I. Tale mu naught n I theke we have found out the value of I. This is going to be b divided by mu naught into n. Mone rakho, this n is not the number of turns. This is the number of turns per unit length. Number of turns divided by total number of turns divided by total length of the solenoid. So in terms of that, now you are expressing. Okay, now L has also come into the picture. You can see L has also come into the picture. One by two mu naught. We have mu naught n square into AL. Okay, mu naught n square into AL. This is the expression for the self-inductance for the solenoid. Mu naught n square into AL. We have already done it in the chapter of self-inductance. Mu naught n square AL, then B by mu naught n whole square. Okay. So 1 by 2 mu naught B square into A into L. And magnetic energy per unit volume is written as divided by AL. Okay, AL is the volume. This is the volume part, no? So divided by volume. So we get the magnetic energy stored per unit volume B square by 2 mu naught. Okay. And electrical energy, though, we know that half epsilon naught square. Acha. Now, after that, we come to the AC generator. After that, we come towards the AC generator, alternating current generator. Questions may come from that topic also. It's not that it is not important at all. It is somehow important. In some cases, the questions are coming. But I'll tell you to give the maximum priority on the rotational EMF, motional EMF part. Okay. And to some extent, to Faraday's law also, you can go through once. Lenz's law also. Achha, here. In the AC generator, the induced EMF was equal to the induced EMF was expressed as N d phi v by dt. Now for the number of turns N d phi by dt. Okay, so here the phi flux is how much? B a cos theta. Now theta here, what is changing? Neither B is changing nor area is changing. Here B and area is constant. This is constant. This is also constant. This omega t is varying. Na? This is the case where you get the induced EMF by because of the rotation, because of the change of the direction of area vector and magnetic field. Here, what is the direction of, if I see the diagram, in the diagram, this is the direction of your magnetic field from the north pole towards the south pole. This is the direction of your magnetic field, B vector. Na? And the area vector is this one. It is not possible to show you the area vector. In fact, actually, in the 2D diagram, the area vector is actually upward like this. This is the area vector. Okay. It is perpendicular to the area. This is your armature. Now, if it rotates, now presently I can understand it is a 90 degree angle. Now, as it is rotating, theta changes. Now, if it's angular, this is your shaft. It is rotating actually. Now, if it rotates with an angular frequency of omega, then theta equals to what? Omega into t. After the time t, theta equals to omega t, angular displacement. So we have expressed theta as omega t. Then BA cos omega t is my flux. So if I differentiate, okay, I'm going to get NA B omega sine omega t. This is our expression for induced EMF or AC generator. This expression is pretty important because from this expression, we have found out moving coil galvanometer also. The torque experienced. Bina, that one. Tale NBA omega sine omega t. And for theta equals to 90 degree, we have the maximum induced EMF. At this present scenario, we get the maximum induced EMF, which is NAB omega simply. Tale induced EMF for AC generator, it is NAB omega sine omega t. Understood? Whatever we have said, আচ্ছা, নাও উইল সি হোয়াট এভার দিস ইজ আওয়ার ইলেক্ট্রোম্যাগনেটিক ইন্ডাকশন। এডি কারেন্ট ইউ ক্যান সি, ইউ জাস্ট গো থ্রু ওয়ান্স, ইউ ডোন্ট হ্যাভ টু সি সেপারেটলি ইন দ্যাট এক্সটেন্ট। আই হ্যাভ নট সিন এনি সাচ কোয়েশ্চেন্স ফ্রম দ্য এডি কারেন্ট পার্ট। আচ্ছা, নাও উইল সি দ্য মাইন্ড ম্যাপ টুডে। ওকে, হিয়ার দিস ইজ দ্য কমপ্লিট মাইন্ড ম্যাপ উই হ্যাভ, আই হ্যাভ কালেক্টেড ফ্রম এ ইন্টারেস্টিং সোর্স। আচ্ছা, সো হিয়ার উই হ্যাভ দ্য ম্যাগনেটিক ফ্লাক্স and the Faraday's law we have gone through already, minus N d phi by dt, induced current is induced EMF divided by the current, and for n number of turns, N into d phi by dt. Acha. Now, next we have seen the energy consideration in the motional EMF, the EMF in the wire, BLV, very important. I have told you to give the maximum priority here in this chapter, in this topic, very important topic, motional EMF. And not only that, rotational EMF is also very, very important. Okay. Tale here the EMF in the wire is BLV. Induced current is BLV by R. Force exerted. These are two extra informations you are getting. Force exerted by the wire is B square L square V divided by R. And the power required to move the wire is B square L square V square by R. It is simply done by current into voltage. And we have got the expression of power, B square L square V square divided by R. Okay, it is dissipated as joule heat. Okay, and the second one is B omega L square by 2. We have already done this formula, we have solved one numerical on the basis of that one also. Acha. This is already done. Integral of Faraday's law, it is not E dot dl d phi by dt. You can just go through once. Acha, AD current, just you can see the definition whenever you're going to get this PDF. The current induced surface of bulk pieces of eddy current, basically induction heater is based on the eddy current. Okay, conductors when the magnetic flux linked with the conductor changes are known as eddy currents. Slotting the conductor reduces eddy current. Eddy current cannot be measured using the ammeter. Okay, it is because of the change in the magnetic flux. So electromagnetic damping, induction furnace, electric power meter, these are all based on the eddy current. Acha, magnetic energy stored, very important point. I have told you magnetic energy stored, go through that once. Half Li square, that energy stored inside the inductor, stored in the solenoid. I have told you this expression already in our NCRT. From NCRT we have seen that 1 by 2 mu 0 B square AL, and per unit volume B square by 2 mu 0. These three formulas, please go through these three formulas. Okay, at a glimpse I have told you, go through these three formulas properly. Magnetic energy stored in the inductor because of the inductance, half Li square. Then in the solenoid, whenever the area of the solenoid, area of cross section and the length of the solenoid is given, 1 by 2 mu 0 B square AL, and magnetic energy density B square by 2 mu 0. Okay, I hope that you will not forget these three things. Positively do that. And the inductance wala part to we have already gone through. Inductance wala part. Acha, coupling, you can see this type of question doesn't actually come, but coupling L1 into L2 whenever, because of M equals to root over of L1 into L2. Acha, I have skipped this part question. This is a very important topic also. Almost I have seen questions from every topic, that is the growth and decay of current. You might have seen that question in every question paper. Growth of, please go through this properly. Very, very important. The current growth in the LR circuit, we express I equals to I0 e to the power 1 minus e to the power minus t by tau L. Okay. And current decay in LR circuit, I minus the same thing is given. Where tau L is the time constant, L by R. I0 is given by induced EMF divided by the resistance. Okay. Please go through this formula well. Very important formula. Time constant is equal to L by R. You have seen a problem was there in the grand test also, in the previous grand test, from this decay of, you know, growth of current in the LR circuit. 1 minus T to the power minus T by tau. I equals to I0, 1 minus T to the power, 1 minus E to the power minus T by tau. So these are our actually formulas in the electromagnetic induction. Okay, so whenever you, I'll send you this PDF also. All the important topics are given. I hope that you have also noted it down what are the important things, and you have to give more priority. Now we'll start semiconductor. In the semiconductor, we are going to start directly with the mind maps. We'll see first of all the overview of the chapter, and from the semiconductor some questions are repeatedly coming. I'm telling you from the logic gates you are going to get 1 mark questions definitely, positively 110%. Okay, from the logic gates one question will be there, and another question from the semiconductor device may come from, maximum priority I'm giving on the diode part. Okay, transistor is coming, but not that extent, because transistor is right now is not a part of CBSE syllabus. Okay, and that is why maybe it's not there in the NCERT. Presently they are not covering in the NCERT syllabus transistor wala part, and that is why though it is a part of your NEET syllabus, you have to go through the CE configuration, because only CE configuration is given, CE mode transistor. Some in the transistor we have some specified formula only, and on the specified formula we have the question. Go through that, but I'm not
giving transistor that. I think there is not in the syllabus.
It is also not there in the NEET syllabus.
Yes, because from the last year only in our CBSE.
They are not giving the transistor wala question because it is not there in the CBSE syllabus. But when I go through the core syllabus of NEET, it was there. Transistor was mentioned. Transistor as an amplifier. CE mode configuration is there. It may come on that section B wala part. Okay, it may come on the section B wala part. You go through this once. Do not leave the transistor. But if you have not prepared transistor, I'll not tell you to study it right now. Okay. Give the priority on whatever you have studied. Acha, one by one let us see everything. First of all, I have the NCERT important parts also. I'll discuss that matter also. So in the types of semiconductor, intrinsic, extrinsic. Intrinsic, now in the semiconductor part, now I have seen in the grand test also you have seen, and the questions are coming from concept oriented. Some concept oriented, like from the intrinsic semiconductor, from the extrinsic semiconductor. If this is the majority carrier, this is the minority carrier, what is going to happen? Like this type of question. Okay. If the temperature is increased in the intrinsic semiconductor, what will happen? Four options are given. In that format, question are coming. And I'll tell you also to give a little bit priority on the Zener diode. Sometimes the Zener diode as the voltage regulator, from that part also question comes. Okay, Zener diode as voltage regulator, see that topic also, because it is a very important applications in different electronic devices. The intrinsic semiconductor mane, this is a pure semiconductor at zero Kelvin temperature. It is at room temperature, it is not carrying any kind of electricity. Okay, it is not carrying any kind of electricity. Extrinsic semiconductor mane impure doped semiconductor. How we dope? We dope by either by trivalent or the pentavalent impurities. Okay, because whenever we talk about semiconductor, if you see the I'll come for that diagram part also. If you see the bonding of germanium and silicon, we have 4n states, 4 covalent bonds, right? Now whenever you have a trivalent impurity, so in the trivalent you have an extra hole, in the pentavalent you have an extra electron. Pentavalent means 5 valence electrons. So you are giving one electron is there, which is going to be move around, and it is going to conduct the electricity. So p-type semiconductor means here we have trivalent atom. N-pen, I have told you to remember N-pen. N for pentavalent. N-pen. Okay. N for pentavalent impurity, and p-type for trivalent impurity. P-type means hole is the majority carrier, obviously, na? Positive type of semiconductor. N means negative type of semiconductor. You can remember in this way. There are dope pentavalent atom, number of electron is the majority carrier here. Ne is greater than NH, and here NH is greater than Ne. Achha. Now in the PN, now whenever these are the semiconductor, only the p-type and n-type semiconductor. Now whenever we have two semiconductors merged. Achha, if I have a p-type semiconductor, if I have an n-type semiconductor, is there in the NCERT question? I'm telling you, I have the question, I'm showing you once. Can you give me this answer? I'll come to this question. I'm not able to find out right now. So we have p-type and semi n-type, we have kept in contact. Will they act like a p-n junction diode?
No.
Why not?
Atomic interaction er darkar hoy na.
Exactly, because they have to work in the atomic level. Whenever there is a certain roughness, and that roughness is it is not in the atomic level, okay, recombination will not take place. diffusion and drift current is there, na? Diffusion and drift current. So diffusion is not going to take place. Whole electron recombination will not take place. It has to be there in the atomic level. Acha. Tale p-n junction diode, a p-type semiconductor is brought into contact with n-type semiconductor. But contact means we not like that contact. It is sandwiched actually by a machinery, a different machinery instrument. The structure remains continuous at boundary. Acha. Now we have biasing. Without biasing, whenever we have a p-type and n-type, there will be a kind of potential barrier. You know that, how the because of the whole electron diffusion. Whenever the diffusion takes place, the electron comes to the direction of p side, and the hole comes to the direction of n side. So positive negative separation takes place, and it creates an electric field which creates its own potential, and it acts as a barrier potential obstacle. It is creating a kind of obstacle. Understood? So electron cannot flow right now, neither hole can flow whenever the barrier potential is there. So to avoid the barrier potential, we have to bias, we have to connect with the external cell. So biasing mane forward bias, reverse bias. Forward bias mane p is connected to the positive, n is connected to the negative, then barrier potential will decrease. And in the reverse bias, you know, barrier potential increases, and if you increase too much of reverse bias, then the breakdown takes place also. We have two types of breakdown: in Jenner breakdown, avalanche breakdown. You know that answer. And the diode characteristics, if I tell you the diode characteristics is here, forward bias characteristics, reverse bias characteristics. So this is called cutoff voltage. So whenever you increase the forward bias a little bit, then current doesn't flow because it has to cross the barrier potential. Okay, the moment it crosses the barrier potential, say at barrier potential is different for the different of types of. It is given 0.7 volt here. It is the barrier potential. So the moment it crosses the 0.7 volt, then the forward current, then the current increases. Okay, then the forward current increases. Now for the reverse bias, for a large region, you do not get any kind of current. A very small current you get, that is because of the minority charge carriers. Okay, it is because of the minority charge carriers. Now whenever the external field, that is the reverse bias potential, is very high, and then what will happen? The breakdown takes place. Okay, and the hole and electron recombination takes place in a large extent. Okay, this is what you call as reverse bias breakdown voltage. So and in that particular voltage, the current increases abruptly. In that breakdown condition, we take for the Jenner diode condition. We take this concept in the Jenner diode. Jenner diode works actually in the breakdown condition. Acha. In the applications, we have seen diode as a rectifier, half wave and full wave rectifier, very important topic. Okay, please see that. Maximum time, I've seen the questions are coming from concepts only in the semiconductor devices. Half wave rectifier, full wave rectifier, please go through. Question are coming from there. Jenner diode as a voltage regulator, photodiode, LED, solar cell. So that part here you have to give priority in the Jenner diode and the voltage regulator part. And just go through the photodiode, LED and solar cell, their graph, how the diode characteristics takes place, how the current changes with respect to the voltage. Now I'm not talking about the transistor in that extent. Transistor part, you go through whatever you have studied, you can go through that part only. Okay, only CE mode configuration is there. You can go through the CE mode configuration. And finally, the logic gates. One question is definitely going to come from there. You know that. Everybody knows. And everybody can do that problem also. Logic gate is pretty easy. Combination of gate will come, I'll tell you. Whenever the kind of some gates, OR gate, AND gate, mixture of gates are given, and you are supposed to find out the output. Maybe in the digital pulse, it is given sometimes the question you have seen, 1010. In that way, it may be given, or some kind of construction of OR gate and gate that given together, and it is asked in the question what kind of output you are going to get. Is it an OR gate? Is it AND gate? Like that. These are the two different types of question are coming from the logic gates. Acha, now we'll go a little systematically in the semiconductor part in more details. We have divided, classification. Absolutely, I'm going through the NCERT. I'm not going beyond the NCERT here. Classification of metals, conductors, and semiconductors. Okay, we have classified in terms of band gap. Band theory of solids, if you study, in terms of band gap. band gap is less than greater than 3 electron volt behaves like an insulator. This behaves like an insulator. Whenever the band gap is greater than 3 electron volt, less than 3 electron volt means semiconductor. And if they are overlapping, if the conduction band and valence band are partially filled, this is the partially filled Balla case. Partially filled valence band and conduction band, or if they were overlap, then they behave like conductor. Okay, there will be enough amount of electron in the conduction band for conducting the electricity. Okay, and here their resistivity and the conductivity is written. You can just go, but I'll not tell you to avoid that because questions are coming sometimes. Suppose some question is given and you are supposed to calculate the resistivity and you are supposed to say what type of material it is. If you do not know the range, you cannot give the answer. So please go through that once. Resistivity for the metals, it is minimum 10 to the power minus 8 to 10 to the power minus 8 ohm meter, minus 2 to minus 8 ohm meter. For semiconductor, it is 10 to the power minus 5 to 10 to the power 6. And for insulator, it is maximum. Just go through one. Resistivity, if you know that conductivity is 1 by resistivity, automatically you can find out. And it is for the maximum 10 to the power 11 to 10 to the power 19, the maximum, you know, for the insulators. Achha, the band gap wala problem I have told you in terms of band gap, how you are differentiating conductor, semiconductor and insulator. Less than 3 electron volt for in semiconductor. We are going to focus on this particular thing right now. Less than 3 electron volt. Now we will see in a little bit details that how it is happening, because questions are coming from the concepts. Here I have gone through intrinsic semiconductor. For the intrinsic semiconductor, mane number of electron is equals to number of holes. Number of electrons, nobody is the majority carrier, is equal to Ni. Tale here, if you see the electronic configurations of either germanium or silicon, which acts as a semiconducting material, tale we have 4 valence electrons here. And they are making the covalent bonds. And now they are making the this is what we call as covalent bonds. They are as usually remaining intact at room temperature. They are not able to conduct the electricity. It is not the sufficient condition that we can make the electron move from its covalent bond. Because to make the electron move from the covalent bond, it requires some part of energy. They are absolutely at the equilibrium state right now. Okay. So this is at room temperature, no conduction. Room temperature, there is no conduction. Now this is actually the diagram that I have taken here. So it is given, all the electrons are there in the, you know, this is the band gap and all electrons there is in the valence band. Okay, and now whenever you have across the room temperature, you have given some temperature, then some electrons will come to the conduction band and they can, you know, are capable of, you know, conducting the electricity. But I want the semiconductor, matlab I want everything in the room temperature. The temperature condition should be minimum. Temperature should, in the room temperature, I want to conduct the electricity either by the holes or by the electrons. Okay. This is the condition in the band gap. Now let us come towards the extrinsic semiconductor wala part. Extrinsic semiconductor, mane doped semiconductor. Here we have what kind of impurity I have given. We have 5 valence electron, money. What kind of electron? N pin. Pentavalent impurity. Pentavalent impurity, yes. Here, pentavalent impurity. So we call this as what kind of semiconductor? Tell me.
Pentavalent
money. N type. This is going to be your N type. Okay, number of electrons is more because you can see this is the. This is the extra amount of the extra electron, and this free electron donated by the pentavalent atom is responsible for carrying the electricity. So here electron is a majority carrier. N is greater than NH. N is greater than NH. Achha, this is what we call as donut type also. This is what we call as donut type impurity also. Pentavalent impurity is known as donut type impurity. And similarly for P type, we have the whole majority carriers. okay? And trivalent impurity, one parts per million. Here the doping is given in terms of parts per million. One in 1 million, very small doping. It's not that you are going to dope very highly. Okay, doping is small, one parts per million. In 1 million germanium atoms, you are giving only one of the trivalent atom. Okay, understood. And this trivalent atom is now covalent bonds are forming with the rest of them, rest of the germanium, and there is one hole. The hole is the majority carrier over here. Okay, so already we have the hole, and this hole is going to be responsible for flow of electricity. This is what we call as acceptor. Now, without biasing, this is the p-n junction without biasing. Acha, here you have to go through this formula, Ne into H, NH equals to Ni square. From here, question comes. I'll give the question also, don't worry. Now, without the biasing, we have electron drifts towards the n side. Electron drifts towards this side and drifts towards the positive side. The positive charge particles, the holes comes towards the direction of n type, and the n negative comes towards the direction of positive, that I've told you, because of the diffusion. Okay, hole diffusion, electron diffusion, it automatically takes place because of the diffusion. Current we are getting by the drift. We are getting the current because of the drift. Now, only because of diffusion, the electron hole pair has been separated. Now, because of that, we are getting an electric field from the positive charge towards the negative charge. This is the direction of the electric field, Anna, from the positive towards the negative. So this electric field is creating a barrier potential. This W is our barrier potential. This is our barrier potential. Now it cannot capable of flowing the electricity. I have to do the biasing. Okay, because this is resisting in flow of electron or hole. The electron cannot complete the circuit, or hole cannot complete the circuit. Understood? Well, here I have written that information already. Two important processes occurring during the formation of p-n junction, diffusion and drift. From here question can come, that's why I have taken that line from the NCERT. In n-type semiconductor, the concentration of electron is more compared to the concentration of holes. Similarly, for p-type, concentration of hole is more than concentration of electron. During the formation of p-n junction and due to the concentration gradient means change in concentration. Okay, in the p and n sides, the hole diffuses from p side to n, and the electron diffuses from n side to p. This motion of the charge carries gives rise to the diffusion current across the junction. So here diffusion current you are getting in an unbiased p-n junction diode. Okay, from diffusion current, drift current question can be asked, that's why I'm telling you. So here diffusion current we are getting because of unbiased p-n junction diode. Okay, this is the diffusion current. And now, whenever, let us come for the biasing, we have already biased it. Biasing of the p-n junction. The first one is for the forward biased. You can understand how we denote a diode like this. Okay, don't do any type of kaida over here. It means Jenner diode, you know. Okay, this is simply the diode. And this side is connected to the positive terminal of the battery. This side, the end side, is connected to the negative terminal. That means it is a forward bias. Whenever you increase the forward bias, for when it has to cross the barrier potential. So up to that, it is different for silicon, different for germanium. Okay, for germanium, it is 0.7, and for silicon, I think 0.3, something like that, 0.3. 0.7 whenever it is crossing, then we get current. Before that, we don't get current. Here it is less than the barrier potential. The potential has to cross the barrier potential, isn't it? Otherwise, the current will not flow. Otherwise, the electric field is obstruct, making an obstacle for the electron flow. we are getting the forward current. And for the reverse, we are getting reverse saturation current. This is the small, it's actually, it should not start from there. It should start from little bit down. Okay, it should start from little bit down. So this is your reverse saturation current. And after the breakdown, we get an abrupt current over here. This is the diode characteristics. Ajay, for diode, what kind of resistance we get? Do you get a linear resistance? Do you get a constant resistance? No. No. We get a dynamic resistance, because for the diode, current is not proportional to voltage. Na? Whenever we get current is proportional to voltage, then Ohm's law is there. But Ohm's law is not applicable here. Then we can write R equals to V by I. But here we write delta I divided by R equals to, sorry. Here we get a dynamic resistance.
Delta V by delta I.
And R equals to del V by del I. Na? Del V by del I. This is what you call as dynamic resistance. As we are not getting a linear graph, we have written already dynamic resistance del V by del I. From here, from the diode characteristics, this is important. Question comes from that diode characteristics. Please go through that once. So, now we had a problem. Where is the problem gone? Achha, here in this problem, the problem has not come out. This is a question actually. You have to find out the forward and reversed dynamic resistance. Tell me. Reverse resistance at 10 volt, minus 10 volt you have to find out. And for 15 ampere, current forward resistance you have to calculate. Find out. What is the forward resistance and what is the reverse resistance? Are they same? Forward resistance, reverse resistance, are they same? No. Obviously, reverse resistance should be greater than the forward resistance. Got the answer? Simple. Tell me what is going to be the forward resistance here. Now you can find out the forward resistance. Tell me. So del, just take this slope.
7 divided by 10 milliampere.
Yeah, take this slope. That's all. This is the slope, na? So like here, del, this is the del I. How much? 20 minus 10. That is 10. Milliampere. And what about this one? This is your del V. What about this one? 0.8 minus 0.7. So that is 0.1 volt. So it is 10 into 10 to the power minus 3 ampere. R forward is del V by del I. 0.1 divided by 10 into 10 to the power minus 3. How much we get? 1 by 100. So 0.01 into 10 to the power 3 ohm. Isn't it? Yes. And what about the reverse resistance? Here, minus 10 volt, current is minus 1 microampere. So like R equals to, whenever the breakdown takes place, then the infinite resistance we get. Isn't it? Whenever the breakdown takes place, then the reverse bias resistance is how much? Infinite. You get plenty amount of I is going to be infinite. So in that case, the resistance gets zero. Whenever the breakdown takes place, then the resistance becomes zero. I becomes infinity, na? Whenever something divided by infinity is zero, at breakdown resistance becomes zero. Layer R equals to I V minus 10 divided by I, that is 1 microampere, 10 to the power minus 6. So you are getting 10 into 10 to the power 6. Then obviously the reverse bias voltage, reverse bias resistance is greater than the forward bias resistance. At breakdown, opposite thing, breakdown resistance becomes zero. This is how we calculate. Okay, dynamic resistance is
breakdown resistance zero hoye jay
keno tomar koto mone hocche reverse bias breakdown
reverse bias e to emni resistance beshi thake
but breakdown ki hocche breakdown current bere jacche na for a particular value of voltage you are getting the infinite current tale current jodi bere jay to resistance kome jabe na ki hobe whenever reverse saturation current is flowing reverse saturation current er jonno tomar for the reverse saturation current some part of resistance is there and obviously that resistance is pretty higher than forward bias resistance also but breakdown condition e to in the breakdown conditions the current is abruptly increasing so next tell me this question's answer you are going to get not absolutely from the semiconducting device it is a kind of you know hybrid type of questions current electricity is also mixed I have seen in the and maximum time you will see the current electricity is mixed and diodes wires are mixed in the circuit and they are given the question so it's hard to find out directly the question from semiconductor logic gate question that is absolutely I'm 100% sure one question you are going to get another one is going to be hybrid type of questions or the concept from intrinsic at extrinsic band gap wala portion from there question can come find out this answer let me take some tea
Sir, option one.
Yes, sir, option one.
2.5.
Yes, sir.
Question is the current through the resistors R1. From R1, you have to find out. Okay. Tell here this bias, this diode is in reverse bias. Reverse bias said there is not going to be any kind of current. Current is zero. There is not playing any role. This diode is active. So here 3 ohm is not playing any role. 2 ohm and 2 ohm. So I can equivalently draw. So 4. So 10. So I equals to how much? 2.5 ampere. Okay. Yes, so now we'll go through some portions of the rectifier wala part. Here we have the rectifier. Application of the junction diode as rectifier. See, here in this rectifier we have two types of rectifier. We have full wave rectifier and the half wave rectifier. The first one is the half wave rectifier. In the half wave rectifier, whenever, now see, what is the arrangement? One, we have one diode only, okay? In the secondary coil, one side is connected to the diode passing through the load. Another side of the secondary coil is connected to the load. Okay, we are getting the output across this V output. Okay, across the load we get the output. Now, tale for the positive half cycle, you know, we have a transformer here and we have a AC source. In the primary coil, we have an AC source. Tale it reverses the direction, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. It is plus, then it is minus. It is plus, then it is minus. Then it is plus, then again it is minus. Okay, so accordingly, the secondary coil also gets induced by the path plus and minus. So whenever it is plus, then the current is going to flow. Whenever it is minus, the current is not going to flow. Minus mane negative terminal mane it is the positive side mane it is reverse bias. Tale whenever it is negative, then it is reverse bias. Whenever it is positive, then it is forward bias. Very simple thing. Tale for the positive half cycles, for the positive, you know, positive peak only you are getting the output. Only for the positive peak we are getting the output here. Tale for the this is the alternating current, alternating voltage across here in the secondary. But in the output, we are not getting the entire, you know, voltage. We are not getting the all the peaks, positive, negative peaks. Only for the positive peak, diode is active. And for the negative polarity, diode is inactive. See, for the negative polarity, we do not getting any kind of voltage across the output. Only for the positive polarity, you are getting voltage. For the negative polarity, you are not getting any kind of voltage. The output voltage for the positive half cycles, you are getting only. That is why it is called as half wave rectifier. Understood? This is what you call as half wave rectifier. See the arrangement. Now, in this arrangement, we have two diodes. Here we have a different type of transformer. We call it center tap transformer. Center tap transformer means here the output we are taking from the center of the secondary coil. This is the primary coil where you are getting the alternative voltages. Here actually this is also the alternating voltages only. And in the secondary coil, we have two diodes directly connected to the secondary coil. From one junction we are taking the output, and the output and the another point of the load is connected to the center position of the secondary coil. Okay, tale for the positive, whenever it is positive, it is negative. Tale in the secondary coil, whenever this one is positive, this one is negative, this diode is active, this diode is inactive. Tale we are getting the current. And for whenever it is negative, it is positive. Tale this diode is active, this diode is inactive. Still we are getting the current. That's all. We have two diodes, and for the positive half cycle, negative half cycle, you are getting both the voltages across the output. This is what we call as full wave rectifier. Now the most important part that you have to more focus, that is the Jenner diode as the voltage regulator. Okay, very important part of this chapter. How we special purpose diode. In the special purpose diode, this is the only special purpose diode which is giving, I am telling you to give the maximum priority. This is the Jenner diode, and it works in the breakdown condition. Hana? Jenner diode works in the breakdown condition. It has, you can understand forward current we are not getting. Now this is the Zener breakdown. This position is the Zener breakdown. VZ is the Zener breakdown. It loves the breakdown. In mobile charger it is there actually. Zener diode is applied. And obviously Zener diode can be applied as a voltage regulator also. Now at this point, certain point, at this certain point the voltage increases abruptly. At this certain voltage the current increases abruptly. Okay, current infinitely increases at this particular voltage. This is what you call as breakdown condition. The whole because of the high electric field, the hole and electron recombination takes place abruptly, and that this breakdown takes place. Jenner breakdown, avalanche breakdown, a different type of breakdown. Avalanche breakdown means gradually breakdown will take place. Jenner breakdown means sharply breakdown will take place. Achha, now Jenner diode as a voltage regulator. What we have done here, we have taken a Jenner diode of suitable breakdown voltage. Okay. Now we have, suppose for example, don't think about the LED, don't think about the RL, take a LED over here. Suppose LED can take maximum a certain voltage. Suppose 10 ampere current the LED can maximum take, and above 10 ampere current the LED is going to get damaged. But suppose then you have a source, 200 volt source, will the LED work on that? No. If you can regulate the voltage, then it can work. If you can regulate the voltage, it can work. Because suppose, for example, the LED can work, can take up a maximum voltage of 10 volt. Okay. So you are going to apply the Jenner diode of having a breakdown of 10. Okay. So below the 10, what is going to happen then? Tell me. Whenever this VS, the source voltage is below 10, then it can work properly. And whenever the source voltage is greater than 10, then if you do not have this diode, it is going to get damaged. Are you getting my point? It is going to get damaged then. So whenever it is greater than 10, then it comes into the picture. It supplies the 10 volt. Maximum voltage it supplies to the, RL. It supplies the maximum voltage to the RL. But and whenever suppose it is 12 volt, 15 volt, 20 volt like this, then 12, 15, 20 are not giving the voltage directly to the RL. Then the voltage is still 10 volt. Maximum voltage it is getting. Understood? So it is regulating the voltage actually. Now on the basis of that, we have a question. You might have seen that question also earlier. It's a very important question actually. Tell me, what about this answer?
So 20 milliampere.
Okay. Ankita has given the answer. Very good.
5
milliampere. 5. Okay. Which one I should take? Okay, let me check. The Jenner diode having the breakdown voltage equal to 15 volt is used in voltage regulator circuit as shown in the figure. The current through the diode is how much? You know this, how to solve this type of question. This is I, for example. This is your IZ, current to the Zener. This is current to the load, I to the load resistance, right? So here I can understand this I is equals to IZ, Zener diode current plus to the load resistance. Can I write it? Okay. Now, whenever it is at the breakdown condition, then 20 volt is not playing any kind of role. It is given, it is having breakdown voltage equal to 15 volt. It is working in the breakdown conditions right now. Here across 1 ohm, how much voltage is there? We can only think of this one. Isn't it? So how much current is passing? IL is how much then? Voltage 15 divided by that resistance, 1 kilo ohm, that is 10 to the power 3. So it is 15. We can do one thing. Milliampere answer there, right? So I don't have to convert actually. This is given in milliampere. So 15 milliampere. So 15 divided by 1 kilo ohm. So it is 15 milliampere. If it is there in the 1 kilo ohm, you don't have to convert. So like 15 milliampere IL. And what about the I? তাহলে ইট ইজ ওয়ার্কিং ইন দ্য ব্রেকডাউন কন্ডিশনস সো ইট ইজ ইন দ্য ব্রেকডাউন কন্ডিশনস মানে আর দিস টু পয়েন্টস হোয়াট ইজ দ্য পোটেনশিয়াল 15 ভোল্ট পোটেনশিয়াল মানে অ্যাজ ইফ ইট ইজ বিহেভিং লাইক দ্যাট ইট ইজ 250 অ্যান্ড হিয়ার উই হ্যাভ এ সার্কিট দিস ইজ ইয়োর 20 ইট ইজ 15 ভোল্ট অ্যান্ড ইট ইজ 20 ভোল্ট কারশফস ল অর জাস্ট কম্বিনেশন অফ সেলস ইউ ক্যান অ্যাপ্লাই তাহলে হোয়াট ইজ দ্য নেট পোটেনশিয়াল 5 ভোল্ট Here it is 5 volt. Tale here V net is equals to 5 volt. Combination of potential, or else you can think in terms of Kirchhoff's law also. Tale here the current I is going to be 5 divided by 250. Later how much? It is in ohm. Tale this is 1 by 50 ampere. Right? 1 by 50 ampere means how much milliampere? 10 to the power 1000 divided by 50, how much we get?
20 milliampere.
This is 20 milliampere. Thale here it is 20. Thale I goes to, you know, Iz plus IL. We need to find out Iz, which is going to be I minus IL. This is 20 minus 15. So 5 milliampere of answer. 5 milliampere. Yes. Ankita, understood what mistake you have done? I don't know.
Say last step ta keno holo bujhte parlam na. Iz plus IL.
Acha, ota bujhte paroni to? Dekhe dichi. See, this is the circuit, na? Now it is working in the breakdown condition. It is given in the question. It is working in the breakdown condition. Tale if it is working in the breakdown.
Current through the diode boleche to total current to boleni.
Mane can't understand that. Tell me.
So total current hole tobe na IL plus IZ kortam.
Here current is this is I na. Tale this current is passing through this. This current is passing through this. It is this current is passing through the diode. Some part of current will be passing through the diode though. And some current is passing through the load. The current which is passing through the load, this is the maximum current which can be passing through the load. Okay, that is what the diode is doing. If the current IL is greater than the desired value, this load resistance will get hampered. And here resistance I'm applying. Actually, here some light, fan, AC, TV, whatever electrical component is there, that is actually applied over here. And this 250 ohm resistance is just saving this diode so that a huge amount of current doesn't flow through the diode and it can save the diode at least. Otherwise, this diode also going to get messed up. Now I equals to Iz plus IL. So now first of all, think about this circuit. So whenever it is working in the breakdown condition, this 1 kilo ohm only having this 15 volt. Think, forget about 20 volt. 1 kilo ohm is only having the 15 volt. Okay. So from there, I have found out the first current to this circuit. Then whenever I'm finding out this current, so think about this circuit now.
Yes,
think about this circuit. So here we have 15 volt. It is behaving like a battery. Okay, so from there 5 volt is my net potential and from there I have found out the current. So now I equals to IL plus IZ. So from there we have found out the current. This is one of the important part. Basically whenever question comes from the voltage regulator of the Jenner diode, it comes from this particular topic only. Okay, I have seen gone through different papers and I have collected this question specifically because I have seen either this question or sometimes it is asked that this value of resistance. It has to work in the this breakdown voltage. What will be the minimum value of this resistance? This resistance is also asked. It is there in the NCRT also. I have found out this question. Find out this value of the resistance so that it works in the breakdown condition. Anything can be asked, but the concept is here. Same. First of all, you will apply this for the second loop, then in the first loop. Now let us solve some small two problems I have collected from the diode logic gates. I should not absolutely skip this part. I know you know that you already are comfortable with these logic gates. It will be a wastage of time, I know. But let us do only two problems we have and we are already at the end of the class. So tell me what about this answer in the logic gate.
Option 2.
Soily has given the answer. Okay. Soily is very quick in the solutions of logic gates. In the combination of the following gets the output Y. Tale A, we have B. Tale B, mane this is a not gate, na? This one. This is a not gate. Whenever it is passing through here, it is going to be B bar. It is A. Tale it is AND gate. Isn't it? Tale what do you get here? Across this output, what do you get?
AND gate.
Yes, Soily.
AND gate.
Haan, tale what will be the output?
A dot B combinatory.
A B bar. A dot B bar. Tale here we get A dot B R. And finally, let us see what is happening here. Tale this is A bar. You can understand this one is taken from this point. Tale this one is A bar. This is B. Tale here in
B
the
B dot A bar.
B dot A bar. And this one is OR gate.
Yes.
Tale finally, what do you get? A dot B R. A dot B bar plus B dot A bar. Option number 2. I think everybody is comfortable with the sign. Now it's not in the condition that I do not know the sign of this gates. Okay? Yes or no?
Yes.
Spending the time in the shopping mall now. Okay. And what about this answer?
NOR gate.
OR?
NOR.
It's a NOR gate. Tale here we have A, B. This is what kind of gate?
NOR.
NOR gate. OR plus NOT is given. This is Golmane, this is NOT. Okay. Tale this is A plus B here bar. We have A plus B here. And we have A plus B here bar. So this is the output input here. Again, we have an OR gate. Tale A plus B bar bar. We have A plus B bar bar. What is that? De Morgan's theorem.
A plus B.
A plus B. So here in this input we get A plus B, and we have only NOT gate. Tale again we get a bar. Tale here A plus B mane OR, and plus we have a NOT. Tale we have. Okay, you are quite comfortable. I can see with the logic gates. One question you are going to get from here. Once your short answer. So this is all about the semiconducting device. You can go through the transistor wala part just for the section B. If you have not prepared right now, I will not force you to prepare the transistor because maybe the question is not coming from that part also. But go through it because from the section B, the deleted parts are coming. So just go through the transistor bell part once also at home. Okay. But give us a maximum priority in logic gate one question. So definitely I'm leaving that part. And voltage regulator, generator voltage regulator. Go through the solar cell photodiode once from the graphical part, graph bala part. Okay, in the photodiode, how it is working, the solar cell. With the intensity of the light changes, how the current changes also in the solar cell, in the photodiode. There's two special diodes. And maximum probability that question comes coming from some concepts of the PN junction diode, drift current, diffusion current, go through that properly. Okay, diffusion whenever you're getting because of unbiased condition, drift current we are getting whenever drift or diffusion both are there actually, whenever the diode is connected with some forward biased condition or reverse biased condition. Dynamic resistance is also pretty important. From the graph it is asked to calculate also. Okay, done. Fine, then you take the rest and you have the class from 8:30 also. I think you're having back-to-back classes, chemistry. Okay, then fine. Take care. Good night. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.